Quest presents an unabridged recording of Taboo by Kerry Barnes, narrated by Annie Aldington. Prologue. May 2012. Paisley anxiously stared out of the living room window, but the second she saw his car pull up, she felt her heartbeat galloping with relief and excitement. He clearly hadn't changed his mind about the offer. He was everything she wanted, and she could pinch herself that someone like him wanted someone like her. She wasn't wealthy or particularly stunning, although she knew she had gorgeous hair. It was long and thick and shone like wet chestnuts, and he had often swirled it around in his hands, gazing as though he had never seen hair like that before. While she had to admit she found it a little unusual, she took it as a compliment. Her mother entered the living room, with tears streaming down her face. She knew now that she had just seconds to convince her daughter to change her mind.
"Paisley, please think about it," begged her mother, while snivelling back another tear. "Please, sweetheart, you've only known him for 5 minutes. At least stay here and date him for a little while longer. I'll even let him stay over. I'm no prude, and it will also give me time to get to know him."
Her words tumbled out in a desperate bid to persuade her daughter not to leave. Paisley placed her arm around her mother's shoulders.
"Mum, he is everything I have ever wanted. I love him, Mum. I want to wake up beside him every morning. And in any case, he's already said I want for nothing. So stop worrying."
Fiona felt her heart sink as she stared into her daughter's beautiful, eager round eyes.
"But sweetheart, money ain't everything, and you hardly know him. You haven't even been to his house yet. He could be a murderer. What if..." "Mum, stop," she said, her voice now firm. "I'm going to move in with him, and once I'm settled, you can come over and see the place all for yourself. Now please don't go on and ruin this moment for me." "Paisley, I don't feel right about this. Please, love, please think about it."
Seeing her boyfriend get out of his luxury vehicle, Paisley switched off to her mother's words. Her attention was now on the new man in her life. Pulling herself away from her mother, she hurriedly opened the front door, picked up her large bag, and skipped down the path. He was ever the gentleman too, taking her overnight bag before holding the door of his car open for her. He bowed when she climbed in, as though she was a princess. As he hurried around to the driver's side, she waved goodbye to her sweet mother, who was there at the doorstep with a tissue in her hand and utter sadness in her eyes. Her mum had said it was infatuation, but she was convinced her mother was wrong. Although she hated seeing her so upset, this was her life now, and in any case, she loved her new fella too much ever to rock the boat. When they reached Petswood, he pulled the car over and produced a blindfold.
"This, my angel, is for the big surprise. You will put it on, won't you?"
She chuckled, not afraid at all of the blindfold. She'd worn it before when he'd taken her on a midnight picnic, and she loved the fact that he was full of surprises. It was so romantic. When they finally reached his home, she was desperate to see what it looked like. But she had gone along with his game and didn't attempt to peek. The sound of her pale pink high-heeled shoes echoed as he gingerly walked up a flight of stairs, so she guessed the apartment was going to be large. And judging by his clothes, his watch, and his car, he had plenty of money. She was shaking with excitement, this new chapter in her life. He whispered in her ear sweet nothings as he guided her inside the apartment. She could smell the sweet aroma of jasmine candles and could feel the comfortably warm temperature. Desperate to see what a new home looked like, she chuckled.
"Can I take it off now?"
"No, sweet Snow White. Wait, I have a big surprise for you. Take your jacket off and let me help you to take a seat. But no peeking," he muttered in her ear, before he gently kissed her lips.
She sensed his excitement. She could feel his quick breath on her cheek. And although she was desperate to rip the blindfold off, she went along with it, expecting maybe an enormous bunch of flowers or a pretty set of night clothes already laid out for her on the bed. He'd surprised her with flowers before. After taking her jacket off, he eased her down onto something soft. It was too low to be a bed, so she assumed it was a modern futon. She had scarcely sat down, though, when she heard a rattling sound, and then she felt him snatch her wrist and clamp something cold around it. She thought it was a gold bracelet. At least she prayed it was. But with no time to rip the blindfold off, he grabbed her other wrist and clamped that one as well. In a sheer panic, she tried to get up from whatever she was sitting on, and it was then that she felt the restraints. It was the sound of the metal chains that turned her muscles to lead. Dread coiled its way inside her stomach, turning every nerve in her body stone cold. She could, however, bring her hands to her face. Instinctively, she ripped off the blindfold and then gasped in horror. Her throat closed up as her brain tried to accept what her eyes were telling her.
This has to be a nightmare. Please, God, let this be a dreadful dream.
But his sadistic grin as he sat on the chair with a sketchbook and a pencil at the ready only served to emphasise the fact that this was far from any dream.
That's it, darling. Let me see how truly terrified you really are, or can be.
Chapter 1. August 2012. William DeFranks stared intently at the name on the piece of paper. He dared not look up at Desiree Deacon before he had assimilated the implication of what he saw, because he knew she would be able to read his thoughts, just by the expression on his face. She was good at that. A woman of her word, Desiree was as hard-nosed as they come, with nerves of steel and a face that hid every emotion. Although fashionable for her 58 years, there was also a touch of masculinity about her, perhaps because she wasn't into pretty makeup and flowy dresses. She was slim and tall, with an elegant neck. Her well-defined jawline was enhanced by her short red hair, and her almond eyes lacked any signs of droopy eyelids or even deep crow's feet for an older woman. Still, her look was attractive, and she caught the eye of many men her age, if they dared to ogle long enough, because she, like her sons, had a piercing stare, if you were brave enough to lock eyes with her. She sat opposite in a self-composed manner, with her long bare legs crossed and her very expensive-looking red summer coat reaching the floor. Taking a deep drag on her cigarette, she raised her eyebrow.
Is there a problem?
William could feel his cheeks redden, and his mouth felt like he was chewing on a ball of cotton wool. No one argued with Desiree, not if they didn't want a backhander, or worse, a ruck with any of her boys, especially from Byron, because he had seen at first hand what he was capable of, and the result was not a pretty sight. The screams from his victim would not stop Byron. He was ruthless, reckless, and had no time-out button. And right now, he was sure that Byron wouldn't agree with what his mother was about to do.
Harper Kane?
Desiree opened her handbag and pulled out a wad of notes.
Is that a question? Well, I am surprised. Am I allowed to ask who she is?
No.
You're not. Now, will you do it or not? Does Byron know?
He realised right away that he shouldn't have asked that question. Desiree jumped up from her seat, placed the money back inside her bag, and turned to leave. William felt his heart pounding away.
Please wait, Desiree.
She stopped and flashed him a glare.
How fucking dare you ask me questions? I've known you for most of your life. I even paid your mother's rent many a time when she was skint. And you have the audacity to ask me if my son knows. This is a professional matter. That's why I came to you. I'm not sitting at my kitchen table with tea and biscuits for a cosy chat, am I?
She stepped forward, stubbed a cigarette out in his ashtray, and aggressively pointed a finger.
Do you seriously think that Byron or any of my sons would have the fucking right to question me? No. Sorry, look. Please, sit down. I didn't mean to...
The trouble is, and always has been, that you and my sons saw their father rule the roost, and you watched him push his boys to be governors, bosses, leaders, or whatever you want to call them. But he failed, because the three of them couldn't run a kid's party, let alone a fucking nightclub. And Tony never left a will to include his boys. She shook her head mockingly. That cocky bastard thought he would live forever. Big mistake. But, she paused and grinned, he's dead and buried. And see me? I am the boss, the governor now. Not him, not our sons, because everything he owned is now mine.
They run the clubs, though, said William.
again saying more than he should.
Run the clubs?
She let out an exaggerated laugh.
They run fuck all.
Who does the books? She asked, as she poked herself in the chest.
Me. Who organises the drinks?
Me.
Who hires and fires the staff?
Me.
Who does it all?
Fucking me. Byron might be your best pal, but he can't run or organise jack shit. William knew Desiree was right. He had seen Byron swan around the clubs like the head of the mafia, except he wasn't. He was Desiree and Tony Deacon's eldest son. He also happened to be his best friend, and right now, his alliances conflicted. Byron wasn't the type of man to be understanding. There was no way he would ever appreciate that the conversation and request made by Desiree should remain confidential. And whether he took on the job or not, Byron would expect to be informed of the facts. At that moment, he resented Desiree for even asking him. As she turned on her heel to leave, he felt dread creep its way from the pit of his stomach to the back of his throat. With a sharp glance over her shoulder, she said,
I take it, William, by that look on your face. You won't do it. And that's fine. But if you dare tell my sons of my visit, I will have you strung up by your bollocks.
Desiree slammed the door shut behind her. Despite the effect of the force causing a minor draft, William jumped nonetheless. Quickly, he screwed up the piece of paper with Harper Kane's name on it and tossed it in the bin. Once Desiree was inside her brand new Audi, she lit up another cigarette and let out an exhausted huff. Even though she'd been the iron lady in the family and ran the mechanics of the business, it had always been her husband who had called the shots. She'd been with Tony for almost 40 years, and she had once upon a time loved him dearly. His reputation in the underworld was a turn-on back then, but not so much in the later years. However, she could never deny he'd been a good-looking man, with big broad shoulders and a full head of thick wavy hair. But it wasn't just about his looks. It was the fact that she loved a manly man, a man with clout and respect. On so many occasions in the later years, she had questioned her feelings. Had it all been about the excitement, the ducking and diving, and the way his associates treated her? Or had she, deep down, really loved him? She flicked the ash out the window and sighed again. She often found herself sighing since Tony had been laid to rest. Everyone assumed it was because she missed him, and in some ways she did. Yet there was always that incident that came flooding back to her time and time again. What really happened to her baby? Even on his deathbed, she'd longed to know the truth, and so she'd whispered in his ear. Did you hurt our baby girl, Tone? Was it you? I will forgive you, Tone, and so will God if you tell me the truth. Confess your sins and go to heaven. Even thinking about it made her eyes water. She sniffed back the tears and started the engine. Glancing at the briefcase, she knew she had to make one more stop before heading back to her house in Sundridge Park. She wasn't conscious of the place being quieter since Tony had died, because in truth, he had spent most of his time out and about. He was out when he'd had his heart attack. He'd collapsed on top of some brass. For the sake of the neighbours and his so-called friends, she'd kept that fact a secret. There was no point in slurring his name. What difference would it make now? He was 6 feet under. Although what she'd found very odd was her son's reactions when she'd casually mentioned it to them at the wake for their father. They had acted as if their father cheating on their mother was perfectly normal. So she assumed that they also knew he had been seeing other women or prostitutes. Tony didn't die right away. He was taken to the hospital where he died 3 days later, and in that time, she tried to get him to tell her the truth about the baby. But he acted as if she was talking a foreign language to him. Still parked in the drive was Tony's brand new Range Rover. She would have to sell it sooner rather than later, to park her car nearest the front door. The door opened before she even had a chance to slide the key in the lock. Standing 6 feet tall, with a head like a battered bowling ball, with dents and scars and a corrugated nose, was Augustus, nicknamed Oggy, Tony's brother. His bulldog jowls and heavy bottom lip softened his otherwise hard man appearance. All right, Oggy?
I let myself in. I've still got a key. You didn't mind, Des, did you?
Desiree said nothing, but simply held her hand out. Oggy grinned nervously.
Oh, yeah, right, sorry.
He patted his trouser pockets, obviously searching for the key. Then he remembered they were in his jacket pocket, which he had left over the back of the armchair in the lounge.
What are you doing here, Oggy?
He allowed her to walk on ahead into the lounge.
I wanted to chat. You didn't answer the phone, and so I came around to check you were okay.
Desiree removed her coat, oversized bag and handbag and slung them on the sofa before she marched past him and into the kitchen.
So, what did you want to talk about?
She asked, over her shoulder. Her voice was flat and cold. Oggy leaned on the doorframe.
You know, to check on how things are going. See if you needed any help. That kind of thing.
Desiree flicked the switch on the kettle and turned to face Oggy. He was Tony's double, except bigger with less hair. His eyes were dragged down at the sides, as if he was always sad, and she wondered if he was, because he had always been in Tony's shadow. A year younger, and they could have been twins. However, there was something about Oggy that Desiree had always found off, although she could never quite put a finger on it. Maybe it was his stare, or his shifty eyes.
Oggy, you have a short memory, mate. I do everything myself. I run this bleeding great big house. I brought up my three boys without your brother so much as changing a shitty nappy. And as you bleeding well know, I've been running the clubs and doing the accounts. So tell me, why do you think I need your help now? I've never had it before, and I've never needed it either.
She watched him cast his eyes to the floor and knew then she'd been a little too harsh.
I just thought that you might be in a bad place, you know, with grief and all.
Desiree let out a chuckle.
Oh, for fuck's sake, Oggy. I was sad when he died, and yeah, I miss him occasionally. But the truth is, I won't be crying into me cornflakes every morning. I'm a busy woman, and you know I hate any fuss. So you stop worrying about me and worry about yourself. I'm sure you have your own business to be cracking on with, don't you?
I've never understood you, Des. When me brother was alive, you never said too much, but now you've changed.
But I haven't changed, Oggy. When Tony was alive, he had enough to say for the both of us, and so 9 times out of 10, I'd keep me mouth shut. I learned when to pick my arguments, but he's gone, Oggy, and so now I will have a lot more to say.
She could tell he was narked by her shutting him down, but she didn't care.
Look, Des, there's a lot you don't know about the business, and well, that was my part of the business, if you know what I mean.
She sighed. Oggy, if your part of the business has anything to do with my clubs, then sorry, mate, but it all ends today. I want a clean business, no funny stuff, no drugs, no imported vodka, and no brasses, no matter how fucking long their legs are.
Oggy's eyes widened, and his face went red.
No, Des. You don't understand, girl. The clubs don't make that much dough. It's everything else that goes on in the clubs that makes the bulk of the money.
He ran his sweaty hands through his hair.
But you, Oggy, you don't seem to understand. There is no more Tony. The clubs are mine, and you, she rudely pointed, forget that I do the accounts. So no matter what Tony led you to believe, remember this. He was a greedy bastard. The clubs take enough money for my comfortable living, thank you very much.
So, Oggy, it looks like you will have to take your business elsewhere. Besides, I have a plan for the clubs, and it doesn't include brasses, cocaine or dog rough vodka.
You can't fucking do that, Des!
His otherwise deep gravel voice was petering out on a shrill note like an irate woman.
Oh, but I can, and Oggy, I fucking will. Des, what's got into you? You don't need to be running nightclubs at your age. You should leave the business to the boys and me. Look, I tell you what, you take a nice tidy wage, and if you still want to check over the books, then fine.
Desiree was used to her husband coming out with belittling comments. However, she certainly wasn't going to tolerate any from her brother-in-law, who for some reason seemed to believe he could step into her husband's shoes. She didn't go off the deep end. She simply held out her hand. Oggy stared at her, now baffled.
The keys to my house, Oggy, please.
Look, sorry, Des. I didn't mean to upset you. I only want to do right by you.
Keys, Oggy, she said,
with finality in her tone. Oggy held his hands up.
Come on, girl. We're both grieving. It's been tough on all of us, and we need to pull together at a time like this.
He died after fucking a brass, Oggy. Now I won't ask you again. Give me me house keys and leave.
Oggy stormed into the lounge, where he snatched his jacket and searched his pockets. Desiree stood in the doorway and waited. Then she saw him peer into her oversized bag and rip the briefcase from it.
Where have you been with this?
He turned to face her with a voice full of thunder.
Oggy, get out of my house and don't come back. You have no idea what your brother did to me, do you?
Why'd you have Tony's briefcase?
Desiree marched towards him and tried to prise the briefcase away from him, but he aggressively pushed her away. In that precise moment, she saw his real personality that had always been lurking in the background. His eyes narrowed as he bared his teeth. The gentle giant, the playful uncle, and the sweet brother-in-law had gone. Or had it all been a front in the first place? However, right now, she was livid that he dared to put his hands on her. With her temper now at its peak, she flew at him, tearing the skin on the back of his hand.
Oh, no, you don't, you stupid woman, he bellowed,
as he pushed her away again, this time with excessive force. Desiree fell back, smashing her head on the glass-fronted cabinet. The glass broke, but there was nothing she could do to save herself from serious injury. The shards of glass sliced two deep gashes down the sides of her face. Falling to her knees, she gripped her cheeks and felt the instant oozing of warm blood. A sick sensation rose to her throat when she fingered the gaping flaps of skin where her cheeks once were. Still gripping her face in terror, she looked up at Oggy, thinking that he would rush to her side, having realised that he'd gone too far, and help her. Instead, his face had almost morphed into her husband. His pale blue eyes darkened, and a cruel smirk slithered across his face. The shock sucked the air right out of her lungs, and she couldn't form words. Suddenly realising she was on her own with no backup, and without her husband's vicious, reckless reputation as a deterrent, she knew now she was an easy target. What she hadn't expected was her enemy would be a member of her own family.
You try anything stupid like that again, Desiree, and next time, well, let's just say the consequences will be worse. My idiotic brother should have sorted this business out before he died, and now it seems that it's left to your boys and me to deal with. Don't ever ask for my keys back again. I have a right to be here because this is my brother's house, and I have an equal share in the business.
His voice was now like a dull buzzing sound as Desiree lost consciousness. Desiree came to when she heard the door slam shut. Her eyes barely focused, yet she could see the blood all over her hands. The sick feeling was still there when she got to her feet and headed for the phone in the hallway. She knew her injuries were more than grazes because the blood was dripping and leaving a trail on the floor as she walked. With the sticky claret all over her fingers, she struggled to dial 999, but eventually the operator answered.
Which service do you require? Ambulance, please, she replied,
realising that she couldn't even speak clearly. The glass must have done some severe damage to her muscles or nerves.
Ambulance? Yes, she hissed.
The ambulance arrived 5 minutes later. In that time, Desiree managed to collect her bag and her coat and wait on the doorstep in case she fainted and the paramedics couldn't get into the house. The young female paramedic introduced herself as Wendy and spoke in a gentle, comforting voice. Desiree wished at that moment that she had been wrapped around soft-spoken people who had a caring disposition. Instead, she'd been picking up after a lazy husband and their three sons, and what had been worse was that not one of her children had even spared the time to ask her how she was doing. They all had mental issues and all had foul mouths, with not a kind heart among them. Even the girls she had hired to work behind the bar were cold and hard. She had regrets and wishes, and yet she had made her bed and had to lie in it.
Things are going to change, she told herself,
as she gripped her handbag that contained the relevant paperwork. Oggy had taken the briefcase with him, but she didn't need that now. She'd only wanted to stop him from seeing the business card her new solicitor had given her. Fortunately, that was in her handbag. Chapter 2 Dolores was singing along to Beyoncé's Single Ladies, Put a Ring on It, when Harper came in through the back door.
Cool, Mum, the kitchen looks lovely. Have you painted it?
Dolores dried her hands and beamed.
Since the council did it all up after the fire, I feel like a new woman. And with all those new resolutions, witch girl, I've continued to keep, as you well know, I've kept this house clean, tidy and fresh.
Now that I've decorated upstairs again, I thought I'd start on the kitchen myself. I didn't much fancy that beige colour, so I changed it to a cherry white. Much brighter, I think.
It's smashing, Mum, but honestly, it seems every time I come here, you've painted another room.
Dolores loved hearing her eldest daughter call her Mum. It had been such a long time, she couldn't actually remember when Harper had called her that. Dolores, or Mother, often said with a touch of sarcasm, had been in force, much to her great regret. But things had changed. The tension between them had gone, and she was enjoying her eldest daughter's company.
Mum, I bought some new bits for Yosef.
She looked past her mother to see if her sister Lexi was around.
You've just missed them. Lexi's taken Yosef to the nursery, and he loves it there. She'll be back in a minute. Cuppa, she said, holding up a new mug.
Before the fire claimed her house a year ago, all the cups, plates and saucers were chipped for no other reason than she hadn't spent her money on the house. Usually, it had been just for booze. Harper placed the shopping bags on the small kitchen table and pulled out a chair. Dolores noticed how Harper was staring into nothing.
Aye, what's up, girl?
A deep, exhausted sigh left her mouth.
Well, you might as well know. Vadim has gone back to his wife.
Wife? Shrieked Dolores.
Harper nodded.
Well, I'll be buggered. Did you know he was married?
No, of course I never. Fucking hell, what'd you take me for? I'm no homewrecker.
What a bastard, said Dolores,
as she patted Harper's shoulder.
It's not so straightforward, you see. Vadim was married to this girl and she didn't tell him that she was sick with a debilitating disease. Anyway, a month after their wedding, she was in a wheelchair and then confined to a bed. So their marriage never really got off the ground. He looked after her until she didn't know who he was anymore, and then she went into a very expensive nursing home.
Oh, blimey. Poor woman. And I guess poor Vadim. But nevertheless, Harper, he should have told you. You loved him, didn't you?
Harper shook her head. No, Mum, I didn't. He was handsome, and we had a good laugh. We had a lot of fun together, but we never loved each other. Nothing like that. I forgave him. I guess he had needs, and so did I. Anyway, he's selling up.
Oh, Harper, what are you going to do? You always have a room here, though. You do know that, don't you?
Harper raised her brow and chuckled.
Oh, leave off, Mum. I couldn't live with you.
Dolores rolled her eyes.
No, I don't reckon you could. Anyway, there's always your room if you're desperate. Yosef is still in Lexi's room with her.
Mum, he signed the flat over to me.
Throwing her hands to her mouth, Dolores gasped.
Really? He's given you that beautiful flat?
Well, girl, you can't tell me he didn't love you. Either that, or when he got run over, he suffered a harder crack to his nut than the doctors realised.
Who knows? He may have. But it doesn't matter now. As I said, he's gone back to Russia.
Yeah, but you said his wife is in a nursing home now.
Harper nodded. Vadim is a principled man. He won't leave Russia until his wife dies, that's for sure.
And they didn't have kids?
Harper shook her head.
No, he can't have children.
How is he now?
Well, he has a nasty scar down his head and neck, and he's still walking with a limp, but he's alive, luckily.
And you don't think his accident has anything to do with him wanting to go back to Russia, do you?
What?
No. Some prick mowing him down and leaving him for dead may have made him question living in the UK. But no, he has to go back to be with his wife.
Oh, right. Well, anyway, fancy a cuppa?
Harper waved her hands.
No tea for me. It's making me feel sick. I'll have a coffee, please.
Oh, Christ, you ain't pregnant, are you?
Harper glanced up, with shock showing all over her face.
What? No, don't be daft. I just feel sickly, that's all.
The conversation was cut dead when the door opened and in bustled Erin. She looked a mixture of bright colours. Her dress was cerise pink satin, with the lace of her orange bra sitting above the low-cut neckline. Her hair, which was down to her waist, hardly moved with the amount of hairspray holding the curls in place. Yet more noticeable, and even shocking, was the colour of her skin. Harper wanted to laugh, because all she could see was a Dorito with pink lipstick. Erin looked Harper over and offered her a half-smile. They would never be close sisters. Not like Harper was with Lexi. But then again, Harper had good reason to dislike her. After all, she had shit on her from a great height by stealing her boyfriend and taking her son as her own.
I was just making Harper a coffee. Want one? Asked Dolores, who was close to Erin, her favourite daughter. So, what brings you here, Erin?
I'm off to Marbella with...
She paused and looked at Harper.
With Greg.
Greg? Erin folded her arms and looked Harper up and down as though she was a bit of shit.
Yeah, Greg. Teddy didn't want me, not after you swanned back into his life.
Whoa, back up, Erin. What do you mean? Dolores placed the coffee in front of Harper and quickly intervened.
Erin, tea or coffee, love?
Erin snapped back.
Nothing. I've suddenly got a bitter taste in my mouth. Hold up, Erin. What do you mean by swanned back into his life? You can't blame me for your breakup. But bloody hell, it's only been 5 minutes and you're off with another man to Marbella.
Come on, Harper. Don't take me for a fool. You know, as well as I do, that the day you came out the nick was the day Teddy fell in love with you all over again.
I didn't stand a fucking chance. I tried. I even tried to look like you, but nothing worked, and I think you know that already. Anyway, I ain't wasting my life hoping that things will work out with him and me. I don't even like the big-headed bastard he is now. You can have the prick.
She raised her chin proudly.
I've got a better fella, and I've got myself a brand new flat. It's plusher than yours and all.
Harper could almost taste the venom from the green-eyed monster as Erin spewed her hateful words.
Greg is a decent bloke and wants to take me to Marbella. So, Mother, can you feed Twinkle me cat while I'm away?
Yeah, leave us a key and I'll pop in. Make sure he's okay.
Well, tell us about this Greg. Is he good-looking, rich, got a good job?
Erin was about to answer when Harper jumped in.
How is Eddie? I mean, was he all right when you moved out? How's he coping?
Erin huffed loudly like a petulant child.
He couldn't give a rat's arse if I was there or not. All he cares about is that fucking wanker of a father of his. And you, if you must know.
Her eyes burned into Harper's. She could see a glint of pleasure. So, wasting no time, she handed her mother the key and left.
Mum, did you know she was seeing someone else?
Yeah, she sighed. I knew Erin had been out and about with her so-called mates, and I'd heard rumours that she was seeing other men, but I had no idea that she was serious about this Greg bloke.
Dolores took a seat opposite her daughter.
I know Erin and Teddy were arguing a lot when you came home from prison, and I'll be honest with you, Harper, Erin has never been the faithful type. She screamed and hollered at you because we all know that Teddy has always loved you, but she was more jealous than anything. She couldn't bear the fact that Teddy loved you more than her. And yeah, she was always seeing someone else on the sly. Only now, since she's moved out of Teddy's, she is reliving her youth, with no kid and no fella to consider.
Dolores looked away and sighed.
What is it, Mum?
She is right about Teddy, though. I know that boy could always turn a penny into a pound. We all knew he wanted to be a millionaire, by hook or by crook. But the more money he has, the more clout he seems to have, and you know what that attracts.
Harper shook her head.
Oh, come on, Harper. You must have seen who he keeps company with these days.
Well, not really. Only a couple of faces who had a reputation years ago. But that don't mean that Teddy's some kind of gangster.
Harper chuckled, but stopped when she saw the serious look on her mother's face.
Mark my words, Harper. He has changed, and not for the better. I've heard rumours that he isn't the gentleman he used to be.
So maybe it's a good thing that Erin broke up with him, replied Harper sarcastically.
Harper finished her coffee and rose to leave.
Mum, give these prezzies to Lexi for Yosef and tell her I'll call around tomorrow. I've got to show a prospective buyer around the club.
Harper, what are you going to do if you're pregnant? And who is the father?
Harper tutted. I'm not pregnant. I had a dodgy curry a few nights ago, and since then my tummy's been a little sensitive, that's all. See you later, Mum.
Byron Deacon watched as his girlfriend slid her stockings on and pulled the red slip over her head, allowing it to fall over a size 8 body.
Don't get dressed just yet. I haven't said I'm finished.
Roma shot him a fiery glance.
Don't you fucking tell me what to do, Byron. I ain't a fucking prozzy that you pay. I'm your fiancé. Besides, you were at it for too long. My mini's red raw, and all because you fucking snorted that long line of cocaine. I told you, no more.
Byron leapt from the bed and gripped her arm.
Don't get mouthy, Roma. I told you before I hate lippy women. So carry on, and I'll be on the hunt for a new bit of skirt.
Crack on, then, fucking telly tubby.
Byron let go of her arm and sat back down laughing.
You're a wild one, you.
And don't you forget it, Byron. Now, I'm off to the sunbed shop and then the hairdressers. Shall I call in at your mum's, you know, to show my face?
There is no talking to that woman. She ain't just going to hand over the business to me, and she made that quite clear.
You have no decorum, respect or manners for your mother, and you're always so rude to her. And you know what? Rudeness is a weak person's version of strength. I read that once, and it's true.
Watch your mouth, girl, and don't interfere in business that don't concern you. And for the record, I do respect my mother.
Roma gave him a mocking laugh.
Yeah, sure you do. The only manners you show are wearing a smart suit when you ask her to do your washing. Now, I'm going to pay her a visit and see if I can't talk her around.
Byron lowered his harsh tone.
If you must. I've got to see Oggy later. I've had about 5 missed calls. Anyway, I texted him to say I'd meet him, so I'll see you back here at 7 p.m. sharp.
Fuck off, Byron. I'll be back when I'm back.
She screwed her nose up. Byron laughed it off, but inside he was annoyed that she would dare to speak to him like that. However, if he pushed her too far, she would walk, and there would be men queuing up a mile long ready to ask her out. He wasn't blind or stupid. He could see that Roma was an absolute stunner. With her thick, dark, poker-straight hair, her pixie nose, and the sexiest come-to-bed eyes he'd ever seen. She oozed confidence from every pore in her body and sucked up to no one. At 31, she'd spent half of her life being bumped from foster home to foster home. By the time she was 19, she had established that she wanted to be rich. More than anything, she wanted to be wined, dined, and caked in luxury. She figured out that the only way to have all that without working for it was to meet a rich fella. Her previous conquests had sussed her out before she'd even managed to get them to put a fat diamond on her finger. However, Byron Deacon wasn't as bright as the others and was shallow enough to go for her looks alone. She was attractive and she knew it, so working her looks and her figure secured a relationship with the eldest Deacon's son. Byron's 4-bedroom detached house in Bromley was classy, and she liked his flamboyant style, the marble flooring, the chandeliers, and the vast open-plan kitchen-come-dining room for entertaining. However, in practice, they never really entertained, only his brothers, his uncle, and the few hangers-on. She didn't fancy Byron. In fact, he turned her stomach when he stripped off. He was a big man, and under a layer of blubber, he was probably quite muscular, but he was too conceited to think he needed to go to the gym. She knew that Byron was using his money and flash-fucker attitude to get what he wanted, and so he never worried about his increase in weight. He was turning into his father, and that wasn't a good thing in her eyes. Nevertheless, she wasn't going to look a gift horse in the mouth. He had money, and she wanted it. A wedding ring on her finger would secure that until the time would be right to divorce the prat. But her plans changed when she and Byron recently discovered that the clubs and the house were legally his mother's, because his father hadn't left a will. She was sliding her arms into a pink check Chanel jacket when she thought about how to approach her mother-in-law-to-be. She had to be more conscious of her tactics. She'd been told by the psychologist when she was in the social services system that she had narcissistic tendencies. They said she should consider others before herself, which may help her advance into being a more valued member of society. But she stuck her 2 fingers up to any thoughts of putting someone before herself. No one had ever done that for her all the years she was growing up. Her mission now was to befriend Desiree, even though she couldn't stand the sour-faced bitch. She would lull the woman into a false sense of security and talk her into signing everything over to her eldest son. And she would use a different tactic from bully boy Byron.
See you later,
she called up the stairs. Not waiting for a reply, she slammed the door closed behind her. Her white Mercedes parked in the drive was gleaming in the bright sun, and she smiled to herself. It was a birthday present from Byron to match the white fur coat that she only wore when he took her to the best restaurants. After visiting the sunbed shop and then having a trim at the hairdresser's, she made her way to Desiree's with a plan in place. She could see Desiree's car was in the drive, so she eagerly climbed out of her car and checked her handbag for the bottle of Jo Malone perfume they were selling in the hairdresser's, either fake or off the back of a lorry. Either way, she didn't give 2 hoots. It was the thought that counted. After knocking and then ringing the doorbell, Roma tried to go around the back, but the rear gate was locked. She dialed Desiree's number, but it went over to answer phone.
Bollocks, she sighed, and then decided to peer through the window, just in case old Desiree was lying dead on the floor.
That would be a bummer, she thought to herself,
unless the woman had written a will leaving everything to Byron. A surge of excitement shot through her at that thought, and she hurried to the window and tried to peer through the Venetian blinds. To her great disappointment, there was no dead body on the floor, but the more she tried to focus, the more she could see a stain on the carpet. It looked like blood. And then she saw the smashed cabinet and the shards of glass on the floor. She suddenly visualised Desiree cutting herself badly and lying somewhere in the house bleeding to death. Hearing a car coming to a stop behind her, she spun around and saw a woman getting out of a black taxi. She could see by the height and build that it was Desiree, but her face was heavily bandaged. This was her chance to run to the aid of her future mother-in-law and play the doting daughter-in-law.
"Oh my God!" she yelled,
as she ran down the drive to where Desiree was paying the cab driver.
"Christ! What happened? Here, take my arm. You look terrible!"
Desiree couldn't stand Roma's fake voice. She knew that she was all about the money.
"Get off me, Roma. I'm not fucking 90, she said in a low voice while she shook Roma's arm free.
"What happened to your face?"
"Plastic fucking surgery, that's what. Now, I want to be alone if you don't mind."
But Roma ignored her.
"I'll put the kettle on. You take a seat," she said, pushing the door open the second Desiree unlocked it. "Go on, Des, put your feet up. You look like you're ready to faint."
Desiree knew she was feeling lightheaded. The consultant said she should stay in for a couple of days, but that wasn't going to happen. One night was enough. The surgeon was called in from St. Peter's Hospital in Chertsey, a specialist in facial knife wounds, although the cuts were from the glass. Nevertheless, he was thorough and promised her that the scarring would be minimal, the nerves would knit back together, and she would be able to smile soon enough. But she wondered if she even wanted to smile again. Desiree dropped her bag beside the sofa and eased herself down. The anaesthetic was still in her system, and all she wanted was to curl up on her warm, puffy sofa, have the TV on in the background and fall asleep.
"I'll make you a cup of tea. Do you want any tablets? Painkillers? I know after my boob job, all I wanted was morphine. Did they give you any?"
Desiree's nerves were shot to pieces, so Roma's voice was like fingers running down a chalkboard.
"Why are you still here?"
"Christ, Des, I can't leave you alone like this."
"Thanks for the offer, but I don't need you or anyone. I'm not a needy woman."
Roma knew she had to change her attitude. This was her chance to become like a daughter to Desiree.
"Des, I understand that you are an independent woman, and to be honest, I admire you and..."
"Roma, cut the crap and fuck off, love. Have you not yet got the message? I want to be on my own, and I have someone coming over anyway."
Roma couldn't hide the annoyed expression on her face. "Who?" she asked in a snappy tone, completely forgetting her plan. Desiree stood up to face Roma. She pointed to the door.
"Never you mind who. It's none of your business. And if you think I don't know why you're here, then you are delusional. Now take your pretty little ass out of my house, and I'll thank you for not coming back. As I said, I've got company and a shedload of business to take care of."
"You should let the boys take the weight of it off you. Listen, sugar tits, let's not pretend we like each other, because we don't. You happen to be Byron's bird, and that's all you are to me. I'm Mrs. Deacon to you, not Desiree, and certainly not Des. So go home and stay out of my business. And Byron will get the same warm welcome if he thinks he can come over and act the caring son. Fuck me, you're like vultures."
Roma shot a glance at the bloodstains on the floor and the broken cabinet.
"Plastic surgery, was it?"
"Roma, just fuck off!"
With a nasal huff, followed by a smirk, Roma left, not even bothering to close the door. As Desiree passed the hallway mirror, she noticed some blood had seeped into the bandages. She was fuming because the doctors had advised her not to speak for a few days.
"Damn you, Roma!"
She locked the doors, put on the bolts, and called a locksmith. That way, no one could casually wander into her home. She wished she did have company, someone who genuinely cared, but it had to be someone who wasn't after her for something. Her husband had only been after her back in the day, because she had been a good catch. Her boys only ever asked her for money, their washing done, or an alibi. They never considered that if they were ever found guilty of their crimes, she could also go to prison. In fact, she had no one around her who cared at all. And now she kept seeing Oggy's face with that nasty, evil grin. The one man she hoped would perhaps care a little bit had shown his true colours, and now here she was, even though she hated to admit it, scared of him. The worrying truth was staring her in the face. She had absolutely no one. Chapter 3. With his mind on Roma as he drove to the club, Byron almost crashed the Range Rover when he drove out of a turning without looking. But the long beep from the other motorist pulled him out of his daydream. He hadn't given the urgency in Oggy's text too much thought, because as far as he was concerned, Oggy was just his uncle. Byron saw himself as the top dog now and wanted to walk in his father's shoes. However, he had been making stupid mistakes, like forgetting to charge his phone before leaving the house. He knew the battery was low because when he messaged both his brothers to meet him at the club, the phone was showing just 6%. Byron liked the tone. It was the smaller of the two clubs, more of a wine bar, and it was based at the back of the Clockhouse railway station, the posher part of Penge and away from Beckenham, where the clubs were already very well established. It used to be a pub, but his father had managed to gain a club licence because he'd used his brains and influence to befriend the local MP and the decision-maker who sat on the council. He had also used a little knowledge and a few compromising photos to get what he wanted, as well as the money from a robbery a few years previously to secure the property. Parking behind the club, Byron entered via the back door, surprised to find the bins overflowing he tutted. Usually, his mother would have had them taken away. Directly in front of him was a small hallway that led to the bar. To the left was the office, which their father mainly used for any business meetings. It was strange to be in the room without their father sitting in the chair. Their mother used the smaller room opposite for accounts and extra storage for the soft drinks. He kept his own stock of dodgy vodka and champagne there too. But when he glanced around and even checked under the desk, he saw the bottles had gone.
"Mother!" he yelled.
He assumed that she had got rid of them. It had been a nice extra earner for him. He bought in cheap vodka, relabeled it as Grey Goose, and had one optic with the cheap version and one with the genuine spirit. If a punter complained that it didn't taste right, then the girls were to say it was the syrup in the mixers and to pour the genuine one to stop any more moaning, or nosiness for that matter. He did the same with the cheap champagne, and if a punter questioned it, the girls would say it was probably corked or damaged, and they would quickly take it away and replace it with the real deal. The club was empty. Oggy hadn't arrived, nor had his brothers. Dax was 2 years younger than him, heavily into the marijuana market, and had grows all over Kent. He used the clubs, particularly the Tone, for his business, and like their father, held meetings in the office here. Dax was also, perhaps surprisingly, the most intelligent brother with good business sense, although he never looked the part. His hair was long and thin at the ends, and his clothes were never smart. He usually swanned around in a pair of faded shorts and a T-shirt, and his idea of smartening up was to change the T-shirt for a polo shirt. Like his father and brother, he could ruck and was never too stoned or chilled to be off the boil. His casual look attracted the women, but he wasn't into shagging every bit of skirt who offered it on a plate, unlike his younger brother, Cody. Cody was the youngest and the best-looking brother, with a permanent tan, chiselled face and toned body. He was the one who the girls made a play for. The three brothers had a reputation for violence, which superseded their importance as successful businessmen, so few were willing to do business with them. Now that Tony was dead and buried, the firm left. So the other businesses that Tony had been involved in collapsed. Because Tony's men weren't going to work with Byron, or Oggy for that matter. Besides, many were ready to retire and enjoy their hard-earned cash. Byron poured himself a brandy from the genuine optic and sighed to himself. He began to think over the past, and he knew that no matter how he viewed it, he had been and still was a bad son to his mother. In fact, they'd all been a bit hard on her. He was aware of how his father had treated her and pushed her around. Although she was a hard woman and had stood up to him most of the time, he could tell she'd been worn down by three lads all making their demands. He knew he should feel sorry for her, but he didn't. He didn't really like her that much. In fact, like his father, he too had little respect for women. Pulled out of his thoughts by the back door banging shut, he spun around to see who had come in.
"So, what's the urgency, Oggy? Fucking 5 missed calls and a cloak and dagger text message."
Oggy held up the briefcase and nodded for Byron to go into the main office.
"I've been trying to get hold of you since yesterday."
Byron frowned.
"What are you doing with Dad's legal paperwork?" he asked,
as he snatched the briefcase from Oggy's hand.
"You have to listen to me, Byron. As much as I love your mother, I have to say she's up to no good. Now then, she had his briefcase inside a big handbag of hers. She'd been somewhere with it.
He slowed down his breathing and took a few deep breaths. A bead of sweat then dripped from the end of his nose. Byron could see that Oggy was looking shifty.
Spit it out, Oggy. As I said, you know I love you, Mum. But as much as I hate to admit it, she's turning against the family, Byron. What's going on, Oggy? He asked, knowing that his uncle was holding something back. Well, she was like a nutter, desperate to take the briefcase off me.
He gazed at Byron, careful to choose his words.
Go on, growled Byron. She was too fast for me to stop her. Anyway, she fucking tripped backwards into the glass cabinet.
He paused and watched the expression on Byron's face, hoping that he wouldn't try to rip him a new arsehole. Not that Byron could, because in reality, Oggy was much harder than him.
Go on, said Byron, acidly,
his voice firm and cold and his eyes glaring.
She cut her face, and I offered to help her, but she lost the plot and screamed at me to leave. I called an ambulance, but she was like a wild woman. I tell you, Byron, your mother is having a breakdown or something. I mean, she went completely psycho on me. Is she in a bad way?
Oggy shook his head.
She cut her face, but I'm no doctor. Anyway, as I said, I called an ambulance, but I left because me being there was stressing her out. Why would she have the deeds to the house and business in her bag? Those were supposed to be locked in that briefcase and kept in the safe.
Oggy felt breathless. He ran his fat fingers through his hair.
She's up to something. I tell you, Byron, she's lost it. And the sooner we take control and get our businesses back, the better. I mean, look around you. The cheap drinks have all gone. She's thrown them out. And she's taken on a new bouncer to check for drugs. The Deacons has two new doormen that I don't even think speak fucking English. I'm sure she told them to watch me. I feel like their eyes are following me around the place. What the fuck? Seriously?
Oggy nodded.
It seems to me, Byron, that she will have your brother nicked for supplying from the club. Where is me mother now? I don't know. Maybe nursing a few stitches. You what? You mean she was cut that bad she may need stitches?
Oggy shrugged his great big broad shoulders. Unexpectedly, Byron shot Oggy a probing glare. Oggy held his hands up.
As I said, she wanted me out the house, so I don't know how bad she is.
Byron searched his jacket pockets until he found his mobile. The battery was dead.
Oh, for fuck's sake! Where's the charger? Fucking cheap shit this is.
He found his charger on the side table, grabbed the end of the cable and forced it into the phone. The screen lit up and showed missed calls and a text from Roma, one voicemail message from Dax to say he would be late, and another from Cody saying he was bringing the next load of vodka, so he too would be delayed.
Jesus, we call a meeting and those two drips are always late, and now fucking Roma wants to meet me.
He stopped and frowned.
I bet it's about Mother. Roma had to go over to see her and stick her great bleeping beak in.
The way Oggy stooped his shoulders and scratched his top lip with his thumb, Byron could see the big man looked uneasy. Feeling stiff, Byron did some neck rolls.
So did you go through the paperwork in the briefcase and find out what Mother's been up to? Well, I don't remember what was actually in your father's briefcase. Well, not for sure. But all the photocopied deeds are in there. The house, the clubs. What?
Shrieked Byron.
Photocopies? Where are the bloody originals? Jesus, what the hell has she gone and done?
Before he could say another word, the back door opened and in marched Roma with a face that could curdle milk. Without even acknowledging Oggy, she launched into a full-scale rant.
Your mother is on one. She's one rude cow.
She held her hand up.
I know she's your mother, but well.
She stood with her hands on her hips.
She practically threw me out of the house. Said she didn't like me. I swear to God, the woman should be in an old people's home.
Oi, watch your mouth, spat Byron.
Watch my mouth? She wants to watch hers. I know she's your mother, but she can be so cantankerous.
How was her face? I mean, did she have stitches or a cut, a plaster or what?
Roma had hoped that Byron would be outraged that his mother had chucked her out of the house, but it was clear he was more concerned about his mother's injury.
She had some dressings on her cheeks, but she said she'd had plastic surgery and told me to fuck off. I mean, I was there to help the woman, but she...
Byron stopped her in her tracks.
Leave off, Roma. You were there to talk her around, and knowing me mother, she probably knew it. So don't act so sodding offended. I want to know about her face. Is it bad?
Only Oggie said she fell into the glass cabinet and hurt herself.
Yeah, the cabinet is broken. There was glass on the floor and blood, and her cheeks were bandaged, but she still managed to give me an earful.
Surprisingly, Oggie butted in.
As I was going to say, Byron, your dear old mum needs help. And as she's a stubborn woman who will deny it until she's carried away in a wooden box, she needs to be seen to.
Byron snarled.
What the hell do you mean by that? I mean, medically, because she's going senile or something.
Byron looked back at Roma, who simply nodded in agreement.
Senile? She's not fucking senile. She may not be senile, but there's something wrong. It's probably grief, which means, Byron, that she can't be capable of running the business. You will have to act as her power of attorney, urged Oggie.
Byron sat down in the chair that his father had once sat in when he addressed the room. It still had his imprint in the red leather cushion.
I don't know about that. My mother is a strong woman. She can be a right cow at times, but she would never agree to power of attorney, not without a fight.
Roma's face lit up.
You have to do the best by your mum, Byron, for her own good. She needs to go into convalescence or some type of rehab place, because I have to be honest, I did think she took your father's death a little too well at the time. It's obviously suddenly knocked her sideways, and so she needs help.
Byron looked back at Oggie, who nodded in agreement.
I'll have to talk to the boys.
Roma rolled her eyes.
You're the head of the family now, Byron. Grow a fucking pair and take charge, will you?
Byron glared her way.
Oi, who the fuck do you think you are, coming into my office acting all cunty? Now fuck off home and paint your nails or something.
Roma knew she was pushing her luck, but as much as she could have a go back at Byron, she was conscious that verbally retaliating in front of people would get her a swift backhander, because although she knew Byron adored her, he liked his so-called reputation more.
Sorry, Byron, she said,
although that was a first. She never apologised to anyone.
But the situation will only get worse if you don't intervene now.
Byron swivelled from left to right in the chair, staring into space.
Enough, Roma. I can't just assume power of attorney.
Roma swanned over to him and rubbed his shoulders.
No, you can't. But you could have her seen to by a psychiatrist who can do something if they think she isn't in the right frame of mind. It's called... What's that word?
She knew damn well what it was, but she didn't want to be the first one to say it.
You mean have her sectioned, said Oggie.
Well, that's an option, I suppose.
Byron jumped up.
What? No way. Jesus, the old man would turn in his grave.
From the doorway came a voice.
Have who sectioned?
Dax had arrived, with Cody behind him. They both pushed their way in and waited for an answer. Cody had his head tilted to the side, with his wavy dark hair just below his jawline, and smiling eyes accentuating his charismatic trait. His pale blue jeans and white shirt with just a glimpse of his tan showing made Roma look twice. Being the shallow woman Roma was, she was attracted to his obvious good looks, but there was also an air of mystery about him which she found even more attractive. She'd made a play for him a year ago, but he wasn't interested in a serious relationship, only sex. So she'd gone for the surer bet. Even Dax was more attractive than Byron, but in a different way. He was slim and sleek, and he also had almond eyes, but his expression was moody and sometimes aloof if he'd smoked too much wacky-backy.
Dax, Cody, have you two found mother lately?
Dax let out a laugh.
Fucking mental. She literally grabbed my collar and marched me out of here last week. She said I couldn't come back unless my pockets were empty. She don't want me dealing in here again. Why'd you ask?
It was Cody who answered with a snigger.
He wants mum sectioned. That's who you were talking about, weren't you, Byron? I don't know about being sectioned, but she's acting very strange. She's toppled over and cut her face. And she's been somewhere with the deeds to the clubs and the house. All that left are photocopies.
He looked at Oggie for backup.
Your dear old mum, I believe, is having a breakdown, and if she isn't given the right help, she'll end up making a stupid mistake that will cost you boys your rightful inheritance.
Cody shuffled from foot to foot. He desperately needed money because his gambling habit had racked him up a tidy debt, and he soon discovered that there's no such thing as friends in business, not when you owe money, and he owed a couple of nasty villains a lot. If his mother sold the business, he would be up shit creek.
Well, what do you propose to do?
Byron looked around at his siblings. Their eyes were on him. Now he really felt the weight of responsibility on his shoulders as the rightful head of the family. He stood up as though he'd stepped right into his father's shoes.
We need to make arrangements to have her sectioned. Oggie, you look into it. I'm going to pay Mother a visit and see what's going on with her. I might be able to convince her that she needs to see someone.
Roma rolled her eyes again, knowing only too well that Byron had no tact. Still, she wasn't going to argue. She would continue her support, and then, once power of attorney was handed over to Byron, she would make plans for the wedding. And then she'd be revamping the clubs. She visualised bling, and plenty of it. Chapter 4 Harper tapped in the security code to the click and flicked on the light switch. She gazed around and felt a sense of sadness. Having managed the club for a year now and been instrumental in the changes, she felt she had also invested part of her soul here. She would miss the place if the new owner wanted to get rid of her. In fact, there was so much that she would miss. What were the girls, the laughs, the responsibility, and even Vadim. And not just because of the sex. Although he made her feel special, their relationship had never been full on. He'd spent 75% of the time back in Russia, and now he was gone for good. All those years ago, before she'd been sent to prison for murder, she'd never ever dreamed that she would fit in working in a club, let alone running it successfully. But the takings had gone up, the atmosphere was more fun-loving, and the girls were happier. She sighed heavily as she ran her fingers along the bar. She remembered how Vadim had made her get false nails because she'd bitten hers to the quick, and he liked the girl's hands to look good. Not that Vadim had ever been a bad owner, although the previous manager had been a bitch. She wondered if the new owner would consider keeping her on. She was banking on it. She would struggle to get another job, being a lifer. The bang at the main entrance door made her jump. She glanced at her watch. It must be the prospective buyer, she thought. He was on time. As soon as she opened the door, her heart did a backflip. What are you doing here? Is Eddie okay? Teddy Ryder, dressed in a navy blue suit and a white T-shirt, trumpeted wealth and refinement. He could easily have sauntered down a Hugo Boss catwalk. The sun lit up his side profile and bounced off his golden curls. When he smiled, as he often did and was doing just now, his whole face beamed. Harper could feel not just her face redden, but the butterflies working overtime in her stomach. She'd never stopped loving him. He was her one true love, the father of her son, and the man she'd dreamed of every night for 12 years as she lay on that hard mattress in the prison cell.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.